Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Josh McElveen. When last week's snowstorm postponed Governor Hassan's State of the State address, what initially seemed like a major inconvenience, well, it just might have been a blessing in disguise, and that's because at the 11th hour and 59th minute, Senate Democrats and Republicans arrived at a long-sought-after compromise on Medicaid expansion, something Governor Hassan felt was very important to the state of New Hampshire. And fresh off the State of the State, he's our guest this morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you. So how did this whole thing come together? Just kind of give us a synopsis of how quickly it happened. I mean, quickly is probably not the right word, but how did this happen?
Well, we've been working together, both chambers, both political parties, to talk about how we can best take advantage of $2.4 billion from the federal government to expand health care coverage for 50,000 hardworking Granite Staters. These people are our grocery clerks, they work in the construction industry, they're our teaching assistants. They're hardworking people who are really trying to make ends meet, get food on the table for about $16,000 a year or less. And so we've just been having these discussions. I really applaud leaders in both parties, in the Senate and the House, because both have shown extraordinary willing to compromise so that we could find a way to extend health care coverage to these 50,000 Granite Staters. And I think what we saw on Thursday was the results of these ongoing discussions where Senate leadership announced a framework for moving forward to extend health care coverage to this population.
I'm curious, on Wednesday, was a deal in place ahead of the State of the State if you were going to give it on Wednesday?
Well, we were working together, you know, we were talking with Senator Morse, but this is really about leaders in both parties coming together and keeping the dialogue going. I think one of the things we've really seen over the last year is a return to the kind of cooperation and common sense that in past years has been the hallmark of the way we make decisions in Concord. And so I really am very pleased that we've had this cooperation and common sense around issues like Medicaid expansion and other issues as well. We've really put the foundation in place. We have agreement about what our biggest challenges are, and that bipartisan agreement about those challenges means that we can take our position. We're already leading in the country economically in a lot of ways, but what we hear from our businesses is that we need to make sure we have a 21st century workforce ready, and we're not quite there yet. So we need to talk about our challenges in education, in infrastructure, in energy, and in healthcare, and the agreement on Medicaid is an example of how we can come together and do things the New Hampshire way and move forward.
And I still want to point out there's a ways to go before this legislation is actually passed. The
Absolutely.
Bill was introduced yesterday, the framework of the deal. How actively involved will you be in making sure that this thing doesn't derail itself?
Well, again, I think there's been great collaboration, House, Senate, and our office, and I'm confident that we're going to keep talking to each other. Legislation is always an ongoing process, and I'm sure there are going to be moments when we have some bumps in the road to deal with. But again, I think the fact that you saw a framework announced by Democratic and Republican leaders in the Senate yesterday really is a great step forward.
All right, let's talk about some of the other things that was in the State of the State. One that caught my interest was when you thanked Senator Rausch for his authoring of the bill for a gas tax. You never said gas tax, but obviously that money would go towards improving the infrastructure, the roads and bridges, which a lot of people feel it needs to be addressed soon. Would you support, in its current form, increasing the gas tax to do just that?
Well, Senator Rausch's bill really provides a formula that recognizes the way we've changed in how we drive cars and how much fuel cars use. And so I think the formula he's proposed is a good one. And if the bill that he's sponsoring came to my desk, I certainly would sign it.
Okay. Now let's talk about casinos. You pointed out that Massachusetts is poised to open up the casinos, and New Hampshire will lose $75 million annually, I think was the figure that you put out there. What is the likelihood, do you believe, that this time around it even has a chance?
Well, one of the things we know is that in order to move forward economically in all the various ways we want to invest in the priorities that will help us actually lead the nation in developing innovative economic growth, we need to be aware of what's happening around us. And over the border in Massachusetts, there are soon going to be casinos. We already have some in Maine. And estimates tell us that we'll lose about $75 million a year from our own revenues to Massachusetts and or Maine. And I don't want to be funding Massachusetts' needs. I want to fund New Hampshire's needs with a casino, a single high-end destination casino. Last year, a number of members of the House indicated a real concern about whether the regulatory structure was really in place to properly regulate a high-end destination casino. So Representative Ames and the Regulatory Oversight Committee that we put together over the summer developed really terrific bipartisan recommendations about how we would put that regulation in place. And I think they're very good recommendations. So I really am urging people who were concerned about the regulation last year to look again at this and to make sure that they understand fully what the proposal is. And I think we may very well see people reassured that we have a regulatory authority in place that can deal with this. And I really am urging them to recognize that we can do this in the New Hampshire way. We can maintain our family-friendly brand, but we can still vote to authorize a casino and then use those revenues to invest in the priorities for a 21st century economy.
When you talk about the regulation, one member of law enforcement who testified against this bill recently said basically it shouldn't take an army, 75 officers or whatever, to police something that's supposed to be in the best interest of the state. I thought that was an interesting way of putting it.
Well, I think you want to make sure that you have a regulatory structure that addresses the concerns people have about casinos and about gambling. We have regulatory structures in place for other controlled things like liquor, too. So you need to make sure that we're making the people of New Hampshire safe, that we're protecting our family-friendly brand. But we also need to make sure that the impact of a casino is addressed in our state. And if we have people going over the border to Massachusetts, we're still going to feel the impact here, but we won't have the resources to deal with that impact. That's why I think it's important to have an appropriate regulatory structure in place.
So what will you do differently this time around? I mean, obviously, you have what supporters call the tightest bill yet. Are you going to call lawmakers in one at a time and sit down and talk to them and try to sell them on the merits of this?
We have ongoing discussions with lawmakers on a regular basis about a number of things, and I hope and plan to talk with as many legislators as I can about this and about other things that are important to the people of New Hampshire.
Okay, let's talk about one of the other issues from the state of the state. Now it's minimum wage.
Yeah.
Got a big applause, but there is some controversy associated with this. But one of our recent polls, and I want to point out, said that, let me see, I got the numbers here somewhere, Governor, stay with me, 76% support $9 an hour by 2016. Is that what you're talking about? Because you said we need to raise it, but there was no indication of how high.
What I think we should be doing, we should increase, we should restore New Hampshire's minimum wage. Remember, it was cut during the last legislature, and we don't have a minimum wage in New Hampshire right now. We rely on the federal one. So we should have New Hampshire's own minimum wage. It should be increased. I think businesses and legislators need to be talking with each other about what the right level is, and I'll be following that conversation closely. But what's really important is that if we're going to advance economically, if we're going to lead the country in innovative economic growth, our own hardworking middle class needs to know that they have the financial security to buy goods and services. And so it's really important that we increase the minimum wage. A lot of working people, all ages, from all walks of life need this.
All right, we're going to take a quick break and be right back with Governor Hassan to talk about some other issues facing the State House as well as 2014. Stay with us. Welcome back to Close Up, everyone. I am joined by Governor Maggie Hassan, who is just a couple of days removed from the State of the State address. And we've already talked about casinos, minimum wage, Medicaid expansion. I want to bring up the issue of the gas tax a little bit further down the road. But one thing that you did not repeat was the pledge to veto a bill which would legalize recreational marijuana. This is obviously getting a lot of attention here in New Hampshire. With this, and a recent poll just showed that the majority of New Hampshire residents, slight majority of New Hampshire residents, would favor some sort of legalization. Is that something you're willing to revisit?
I don't think we should legalize marijuana. I think we took an appropriate step last year in passing a medical marijuana bill. I think that's the compassionate and right thing to do. And we're working on setting up the dispensaries that will dispense medical marijuana. We have a really serious substance abuse problem in our state, especially among our young people. Marijuana use among our young people is already some of the highest in the country, and legalizing marijuana will mean that more of our young people use it. It will make our roads more dangerous. About 26 of our fatal accidents in the last 2 years have involved drivers who had used marijuana before the crash. So I think it's really important for us to focus on treatment. One of the things that Medicaid expansion allows us to do is use Medicaid money from the federal government for substance abuse treatment. I want to focus on that. I do think that we should be looking comprehensively at our criminal code and sentences, because I don't think a young person on a first offense should be going to jail or have a criminal record. I think we really need to understand how we can redirect our efforts to treatment when people, especially young people, first start using marijuana. It's a drug that is very, very potent these days, and it's a drug that has really serious health effects on young people, especially adolescents. And I just think it's not wise to legalize it.
And you brought up the idea of changing the criminal code a little bit. That's kind of a fine line to walk, though, because a lot of people are saying, yes, we shouldn't legalize it, but we shouldn't also ruin the future of a young person who gets involved in this. And I'm curious, and I'll use the casino as an analogy. When you supported a casino, you hadn't been to one yet. You've since visited one. You said you would veto this legislation. I'm just curious if you had any personal experience when it comes to marijuana that helped you frame your opinion on this.
Well, I certainly was in college once, and yes, I tried it. But again, what I'm looking at is what we know about marijuana today. It's very, very potent, far more potent than back in the 60s and 70s, and it really has negative impacts on health. We also see what's happening in Colorado and Washington. They're the first places ever to legalize marijuana, and I think at the very least we should see what happens there. But again, I'm focused on a substance abuse problem that doesn't just involve marijuana, it involves alcohol, it involves prescription drugs, and right now a really growing problem of heroin use. We need to focus on treatment first. We need to make sure that we use the dollars that I hope we are going to get with this healthcare mm-hmm. expansion framework to make sure that we are treating people with substance abuse disorders. Those federal monies also allow us to treat people with mental illness through Medicaid dollars. And that's really important, too, moving forward.
And I want to talk to you about the mental illness aspect of it. We saw what happened at Elliott last year with some of the problems in the emergency room. Other hospitals around the state have seen the same thing, where people are turning the emergency rooms because there's no beds at the hospital. Can you use some of that Medicaid money to figure out either to expand the hospital or open up new ones?
Well, we've already opened up some new beds at the New Hampshire Hospital.
But those are already full.
We have a new designated receiving facility in Franklin. We just completed a sentinel review. Commissioner Tumpas had tasked a team to look at what happened in Elliott, not the specifics of the Elliott case, but system-wide. Why are we seeing an increase in these episodes in our emergency rooms? What we were able to do in our bipartisan budget, the budget we passed last year was really a great example of what we can do when we come together in Concord. We passed the most bipartisan budget in over a decade, and we invested in that budget in community-based mental health treatment, about $24 million new dollars. And we're working on getting the community mental health system up and running. That, in turn, caused litigants in a federal lawsuit that had been brought against the state because of its lack of community-based mental health care to the table. And we now have a mental health settlement that we should move forward on that will allow us to build out that community mental health system. What's really important here is that what we're seeing in the emergency rooms right now is people arriving there in crisis because we don't have the right kind of treatment and care at the community level that would help them avert that crisis in the first place. So that's the focus of the investment we made in the budget. That's the focus of the mental health settlement moving forward. And we're going to need to partner, all of us, providers, hospitals, community mental health centers, the New Hampshire Hospital, all of us, to make sure that we're treating mental health issues just the way we would treat any chronic health issue. People need to get the right care at the right time in the right place. We've made some investments in additional long-term acute beds, and we probably will need a few more short-term beds at the New Hampshire Hospital. But in the meantime, we really have to make sure that we're keeping people from getting to that acute level in the first place.
What do you view as the biggest challenge, biggest challenge facing the state of New Hampshire?
Well, we need to keep working together to make sure that we are as well positioned as we can be to continue to lead economically. We already are a leader in innovative economic growth, but what I'm hearing from businesses throughout the state, I heard it during the campaign before I was governor, I've been hearing it for the last year as I visit with businesses on almost a weekly basis. We really need to focus on how we're preparing our young people for 21st century jobs. And so we talked a lot about some of the things we had accomplished. We reinvested in our university system and community colleges, and they were able to freeze tuition for the first time in a really long time. Now we need to make sure that our K through 12 system is also preparing our young people the way they should be. We have career and college readiness standards that our local school districts are implementing. They include Common Core. These are standards that were developed by the states. They help kids think critically. They help them have the skills that they'll need for tomorrow's and today's jobs. And we need to make sure that we're implementing those. And then I called on, I'm going to develop a task force on STEM education. That's science, technology, engineering, and math. We need to make sure that we're modernizing the way we do STEM education in our K through 12 system and beyond, so that we have a workforce with the skills they need, but also so that young people understand where the jobs are and how interesting and exciting they can be in things like advanced manufacturing.
All right, we have about a minute to go. We are in an election year, by the way. I'm sure that you're aware of that. So is this a job you'd like to have back?
I absolutely love this work, and I am privileged to have the responsibility and real honor of serving as the governor of the state of New Hampshire.
But for a second term, would you like to have the job?
Well, I'm just focusing right now on doing everything I can to move us forward.
All right, Governor, thank you very much for joining us on the program.
Thank you.
It's been a busy week for you.
Thank you very much for having me.